Hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining me at this talk about automated accessibility testing. My name is Rian Rietveld and I work for the WordPress agency Level in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, as a web accessibility specialist. I also teach at the Ellie Collective. That's an online learning platform for web accessibility. You find the Ellie Collective at the URL a11y-collective.com. And here's another URL. You can find the text and all the links in this presentation at lvl.li/automated-a11y-testing. First, I will talk you through the what and the how to test and mention some test tools. After that, I will give you a few demos. So let's get started. The dream scenario. You press a button when you commit to GitHub. Or you run npm or Composer. And you automatically get test results for all the accessibility issues. Wouldn't that be nice if you could check anything like this in one go? Unfortunately, we are not there yet, but a lot can already be tested. In this talk, I'm going to tell you about how reliable is automated testing, what are the standards against which you test, the different ways of automated testing, and the best workflow. First, how reliable is automated testing? You make a guess. At the moment, estimated, you can automatically test about 30% of the errors from your code. This percentage is of course depending on the functionality of your code, but 30% or less. Yes, that's not much. And why is that? Accessibility is more than just correct code. What you cannot test properly is the story you tell with your code. For example, is the order of the information logical from the top down? Is the information and the functionality that belong together also placed together? Does everything work with the keyboard? And do blind users get enough feedback on dynamic changes? And does the automatic test software understand what you want to do with your code? For example, if you have a div with a JavaScript event on it. Automated testing is complicated. Don't expect miracles yet. And keep in mind this in everything I'm going to tell you next. Okay. Standards. As for all tests, you test against standards. And for web accessibility, we use the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. The latest version is 2.1 and there are three levels. A is basic accessibility, AA is the global standard, and AAA is the strictest level for special applications. In the European Union, we need to comply to WCAG 2.1AA for the web. And in the US, the previous version, 2.0, is the legal standard at the moment. Besides accessibility guidelines, also error-free semantic HTML is important. The specifications of the HTML Living Standard apply for this. And they are published in an unreadable document, the HTML Standard document. Thankfully, the MDN Web Docs by Mozilla contain a lot of readable documentation based on the Living Standard. But beware, HTML Living Standard is the specifications and MDN Web Docs are documentation, but far more readable. So, testing for accessibility is different from testing for example, correct PHP or JavaScript syntax. You can test in two ways. Test the static code and test the DOM, the generated the DOM means the Generated Document Object Model. And the DOM represents how the browser processes and presents your website. With the static code, you can test on parts and not on the generated page or component. So static tests catch far less errors because they cannot see the complete component, complete picture. So the best accessibility testing is done against the DOM. Tools. I want to address two types of tools, software during development and software on production websites. First, what can you use during development? At the moment, Xcore. Xcore by DQ is currently the best software for web developers. And many tools run the Xcore engine, such as xDevTools, Google Lighthouse, Microsoft Accessibility Insights, PLE, and, for example, the PayPal Automated Accessibility Testing Tool. The way of reporting and the focus of the type of messages may differ, but the underlying engine is the same. And if you want to check the HTML, there is the HTML Code Sniffer or the HTML Checker by the W3C. And then there are countless modules for example, React or Vue. The search engine is your friend here. Most are based on X. And these are all open source, free solutions that you can use during development. And there is software for production websites. I want to mention three. Siteimprove. Siteimprove is a large software package. It also offers more than just accessibility tests. It also offers SEO and performance tests. Then there's from DQ itself, DQX Monitor. And there's the excellent Tenon.io. Tenon is also available by a WordPress plugin by Joe Dolson called Access Monitor, which provides an API for Tenon. These tools are useful to check the entire content and updates, for example, a theme or plugins and changes made by a content manager on a regular basis. It's really for complete production environments. And these three are all paid solutions. The data of the tests are stored not locally, but on the server of the companies. If you want that, that may be a consideration. Well, you might think, all these tools, do they give the same result? Well, it's difficult when one tool says something different than the other. At the moment, a number of companies are working together to provide similar results. And they're grouped in the Accessibility Conformance Testing Project, the ACT. But whatever you get as a feedback during a test, always look at it carefully. It's an aid and not a complete review. Keep that in mind. And keep the 30% in mind. You also will need to perform manual tests with, for example, your keyboard. Okay, demo time. Start at the beginning. Error messages in your code editor. Accessible code is for a large part the use of proper semantic HTML5. Some of that can be checked in your code editor. This is of course simplified. You probably don't code everything in HTML5. But here we go. I created an HTML5 page with 3 errors. This is PHP Storm. PHP Storm provides syntax errors also for HTML, such as, for example, a form input without a label. And it also provides autocompletes for ARIA attributes. It's very useful for attributes like ARIA labeled by or ARIA described by, words that are misspelled so often. But let's have a look at PHP Storm. 2 errors here. Image. If I check the error. It says insert required attribute alt. So this image has no alt attribute. There is another error. Input is highlighted. Associate a new label with input element. This input element has no label. Then, this is Visual Code Studio. You have to install XLinter for this, and then errors are indicated by a zigzag line underneath the code. And if you hover over that, there's an XLinter ensure image elements have alternative text or a role of none or presentation. And here's the input. Ensure every form element has a label. And it also provides a link to the documentation on the DQ University. If you're using another editor, search if there are any add-ons or settings that allow you to do such checks. This is very useful to do them very early on. Next step can be command line testing. You can test in the command line with, for example, PLE, the X-NPM module X-Core CLI, and on reactjs.org there is a dedicated website about accessibility and also automated testing. The same counts for Vue, that has also a dedicated website about accessibility and automated checks with X-Core. Let's give a demo. First, PLE. This is the code of the page with the errors. And for PLE, I created a JSON file with defaults. I can set some defaults on how and which I want to test. And these are the URLs I want to test. And in this case, it's only one, but you can add more. Go to the command line, PLE-CI, it reads the JSON file and the HTML file and reports. Running PLE on one URL, it reports three errors. The image that has a missing alt attribute, the text input that has no name, no accessible name, and the text input, the form field, also has no label. Actually, the last two are the same issue. There is no label with the text input. Okay. Let's take a look at X-Core CLI. With the documentation, you can see there is a lot you can do with that. You can set rules. You can set which WCAG rules you want to test against. You can disable tests. You can save the results. There are a lot of options. So let's see it in action. For example, if I want to test the error page I made, I do X with the URL, and then I see I get different results, and this is because X actually runs the DOM. It runs Chrome headless and reads and analyzes the DOM. So it catches the alt image, it catches the label that is missing from the form input, but it also says heading order with one occurrence, violation of heading order with one occurrence. Ensure the order of the headings is semantically correct. And if I go to the code, I see I have an H1, the next one is an H2, that's correct, and the next one is an H5. So the H2 jumps to an H5, and that's not correct. That's not a correct heading order. In fact, this H5 is actually used as label, visual label with the input, so this causes the error. Because X looks at the complete DOM, it catches more violations. Right, let's look at the website santaclarawordcamp.org. It runs. Please wait, this may take a minute. And here are the results. Violations of list items with 10 occurrence. Violation of region with 2 occurrence. The violation of the list item is actually a WCAG violation. There are a lot of list items not wrapped within an UL element. And the violation of the regions, ensure all page content is contained by landmarks. This is a recommendation, not really a violation. You can also only look at one issue. For example, we go to wordcamp.org and we check the rules color contrast. There's a violation color contrast with 6 occurrences. And it describes where, and it gives you a URL where you can read more about color contrast. I think these are clear, but hard to read and analyze later. Testing in the browser while you're building. Personally, I think this is the most efficient way of testing. During development, you constantly check what you are building. Does it work? Are there errors? Well, while you're at it, also test for accessibility errors and do some manual testing, for example, with a keyboard and not only with a mouse. The go-to browser add-on for Chrome, Firefox and Edge is, well, you guessed it already, X-DevTools. The add-on adds a tab to your browser inspector with the option to perform a test on that specific web page. Let me show you how. Let's look at the website of santaclaritawordcamp.org 2021 with X-DevTools. I open the inspector. I select the tab X-DevTools. This add-on I installed earlier, and I press the button scan all of my page. It gives back 10 serious errors. I have best practices off. If I toggle that on, it gives one more, but if you toggle it off, you get only the WCAG violations. All issues 10 and they're all the same. LI elements must be contained in a UL or OL element. So I press highlight. Where is that then? These elements, and I think they are all speaker rounds, are list items but are not contained in a wrapper, UL or OL wrapper, and that's an HTML5 or HTML syntax error, and it's also WCAG violation. Screen reader users don't get this readout very well, they cannot make sense of it this way. And if I stop highlighting and then I inspect, then I see it's a div for the container of the list elements. This should be an UL and not an L, not a div. Don't div the DOM. Okay, so this is an easy way to check for errors, really at the generated DOM. Let's look at WordPress.org. Inspect. DevTools. WordPress.org has 7 issues with the best practices off and 2 needs review. That means that X thinks they're wrong or cannot determine if they're wrong, they need a manual check. Those are 2 issues elements must have sufficient color contrast, and if I press the highlight, it is text on an image. So that's something X cannot determine with its automated check. Okay, what are the other? There are 5 serious issues. Also, elements must have sufficient color contrast. If I highlight it, here there is a blue link on a green background, which has a contrast of 3.92, and that's insufficient, should be 4.5. If I go to the next one, this is a subheading that is too gray. All these subheadings, these are all other subheadings. Yeah, so this gray is not dark enough. The color contrast between text and background is not sufficient. So this is a way to test your website with X DevTools in the browser. There are 2 additional tools I want to show you. Wave and HTML Code Sniffer. Wave is very popular. It doesn't run X, it has its own engine, and it gives slightly different warnings. I will try this on the errors page. Wave is a browser add-on, and it adds a button to your toolbar. If you click it, it analyzes the page you are on. It has some additional functionality. It says 2 errors, no contrast error, and 1 alert. But it also gives you compliments, saying, okay, this is done right. And it gives you extra information about structure. If I go to the details, 2 errors, the missing alternative text and the missing label. So it catches that. And it gives as an alert, because it's not really a WCAG violation, skipped level heading. H1, H2, H5. And that's the alert. It also gives you, compliments feature. There's probably a language attribute in the HTML element. Gives you information about the structure, about the headings, and about the landmarks. Your headings, main, footer, and if there are color contrast issues, it will report it in the contrast tab. Also a nice feature, you can remove the CSS and look at the page without CSS, if the order of the elements are logical. Well, that's a different way of reporting. For example, look at the website of WordPress.org. With Wave, it has no structural errors, but it has contrast errors. If I view the details, there are 14 contrast errors, and some of them are false positives. Maybe you have to check yourself. There are alerts, there are heading level skips, 1 possible heading that isn't really a heading in the code, but possibly made up in CSS as a heading, redundant links. These are all alerts and not violations. And there are features. There are no empty alternative text, so you also get complements. The form elements have labels, there is a skip link element, and these are is the structure of the page. And there is made use of ARIA. Okay. Let's look at HTML Code Sniffer. That's a bookmarklet. So I bookmark. I get it from my bookmarks. HTML Code Sniffer, and it gives you a report in a floating window. Errors, warnings, and notices. I disable the warnings and I look at the errors. View report. Element missing alt attribute. The text input element does not have a name available, and the form field should be labeled by it in some way. And these are the same errors as PLE gives. Let's look at wordcamp.org. No. Code sniffer. 7 warnings, 7 errors, 11 warnings. I'll disable the warnings and view report. And these are all color contrast issues. So you see, with these browser tools, the way of reporting and what they think is important varies. So you have to look critically at the reports and the results, and also really check yourself if there are false positives or if they miss something. It's complicated. Well, the last step can be testing with GitHub Actions. You finish a piece of code and you push it to GitHub. Via GitHub Actions, you can do a number of checks on the quality of your code before it can be merged. Unit tests, PHP coding standards, WordPress coding standards, JavaScript linters, you name it. Well, you can add accessibility tests too. Adrian Bilonio describes how to set up accessibility tests for React with GitHub Actions, step by step, in a number of excellent posts, automating the accessibility test for your source code with GitHub Actions. The link is in the blog post. He uses JestX as an example to set up accessibility tests for React. With all this said, there is a big disadvantage when you use accessibility checks on a pull request to GitHub. At this moment, you cannot indisputably approve or disapprove a pull request with an accessibility warning or error. The error messages are not reliable yet enough for that. You still have to do manual checks and check for false positives. Beware of that. At last, workflow. Check accessibility throughout the whole development process, not just at the end. So, in your code, in your browser, with your build or run, and if you want, via GitHub Actions. But you still need to do additional tests from the beginning throughout your whole development process. If you do tests only on commit to GitHub, you are too late. It can be a nice extra check, but it's expensive and time-consuming to do it only then. Test during development, in your browser, and that's faster and offers more options. Moreover, you see the whole story, and not only in code, but also in user experience, and you can quickly perform additional manual checks. I say this with the knowledge I have now. Maybe in 5 years this will be a complete different story. Developments go so fast and it's exciting to follow. So, to be continued. Thank you.
Hello everyone, and welcome to the live Q&A session for Rian's talk. Rian, first of all, tell our viewers, how are you and how are you feeling about the second online WordCamp Santa Clarita?
I'm good, thank you. And I want to make a compliment to the organization. This is such a well-organized WordCamp. And having 12 accessibility talks, including a keynote about accessibility, well, that's truly amazing. And I'm really proud to be part of that.
Absolutely, Rian. I met you at WordPress Accessibility Day 2020. And that's where the organizers got the idea of hosting an entire track dedicated to accessibility. So we, on behalf of the organizers team, we thank you for your contribution. Let's jump into the Q&A session, get some questions answered by our viewers. So we'll start with the questions as soon as it comes up on the screen. So the first question comes from Joe Simpson Jr. Testing, in my honest opinion, is probably the most neglected form of website creation. So the question is, what's the best way to convince our clients of the importance of testing for accessibility?
I don't think the client needs to know. I think it's just a part of your quality assurance. You test for a good code, for a good performance, for a fast website. You also test for accessibility as part of your Q&A, of your really quality, your good quality product you deliver. And the client doesn't need to know or be convinced. It's just what you offer. You offer a good product, and accessibility is part of that. In the company I work for, Level, we just take it as part of the product of we deliver. It has to be good. It has to be fast. It has to be performing well. SEO must be in order, and accessibility. And you get a complete package as a good product. And that is how we sell accessibility. It's just part of your quality.
Absolutely. Thank you for the answer, Ryan. Let's jump to the next question. So folks, you can still post your questions in the YouTube chat. We have a team working behind. We have monitors who are taking the question, escalating to the director at the back end. So let's jump to the second question as soon as it appears on our screen. Right. While they're working on it, Rian, online WordCamp, how do you see it? And I'm sure you are aware that the foundation is working hard to get us back to in-person events. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, it would be that. What I think of online WordCamps? Well, I miss the people. I go to WordCamps because of the people. Now you see people like in Zoom, and it's not the same as meeting them in person and having conversations and new ideas and chatting about how are you doing, what are you working on, and I really, really miss that. The advantage of online WordCamps is that everybody can join in. Because I'm in the Netherlands, I don't have to travel to the United States to give a presentation. So that is a real advantage, and also the audience doesn't have to travel, so you can be here and see all the talks. It's a mixed feeling. Like there are more people to attend a WordCamp, and the other is, well, I really miss the people.
Absolutely. I'm joining from Dhaka, Bangladesh, so that's in some other part of the world. So we have a few comments as well. So comments, the one that we have on this, I don't want to contribute to a non-accessible world in any way. This is a personal choice and approach. How realistic it is, right, Rian?
Well, I work for a WordPress agency, and we have all kinds of different clients. And sometimes a client makes a decision, I really want this feature, and we know, well, it is not accessible. What do you do? We confront a client, well, this is not accessible. How do we solve this? And most of the time, if the client really, really wants to keep that feature, we offer also an alternative. For example, if the client wants an appointment system where you can online make an appointment, and that isn't accessible, we say, okay, if you really want that appointment system, also offer a telephone number and an email address that people can call or email to make that appointment, so that there's an alternative for people who are blind or are deaf, because people who are deaf cannot make a telephone call. So you have to give an email address. So different options. And that's then a workaround. It's a client, they're the boss. So if you just give them an alternative, well, it's not perfect, but that is how business goes.
Right, alternative should always give us some workaround, and I completely agree with that statement.
Yeah.
I do see some more questions coming up. So the next question is from Lynn. Well, while testing is very important, upfront planning is even more so. What's that saying? Measure twice, cut once. Like she's saying, testing is important while the process is going. Any comments on that?
Well, when a new client comes in with they want a website developed with all kinds of functionality, That's a potential client. We don't have the order yet. What we do, we examine in front, we test in front all the functionality the client wants. So we can say, okay, this functionality we can implement because it's accessible. This, it needs work. Maybe there's an alternative and this cannot be implemented. And then we try to find a solution or maybe say, well, we have to rebuild it. Or that functionality, we have to build that in-house to make it accessible. So that will influence the price. If there's something out of the box we can take, plug-in, that's less expensive than if you need to rebuild it yourself. So there actually the accessibility starts with if you get a quotation with the research. There it actually starts, and the conversation you have with your client, like what you can build or what you can just grab from a plugin. So start at the beginning. Also test at the beginning all the functionality you will need to implement in your website.
So the next question that we have, it's coming from Joe as well. What is the biggest takeaway we as attendees should apply first after this WordCamp is done with in our own projects? Very good question.
The biggest takeaway about for accessibility, I think you have to realize people use the web in different ways. We are not all the same. We don't use the web in the same way, everyone. There's people use the web with a screen reader, with a keyboard only. Maybe they need captions. There's all kinds of different users. So if you start a project, don't think, okay, it works for me. But realize there are many ways people can use a website. So also think about those people. You have to have a switching mindset. Like, if it works for me, it's not enough. You must also think about other users that use the web in a different way. And I think if you realize that and think about those people when you that don't use the web at the same as you do, that's the biggest win of all, I think.
Great answer. Next question that we have. I'm also waiting for one from my own. I just realized I have a question of my own. Let me just ask that while we have the question. So a lot of the times I get this feedback from clients that accessibility is expensive to maintain. How do you justify that statement?
It depends how you implement it. If you start at the beginning, it's less expensive because you don't have to rebuild everything that isn't accessible. You have to... I don't think it's more expensive. It's maybe you have to structure in a different way. Like I said, your website should be able to be used in different ways than just with eyes and a mouse. If you have a well-trained team, it doesn't have to be more expensive. For example, if you have a design, you can make a complete accessible design if the designer knows what color contrast should be. And if the color contrast is right from the beginning, you don't have to adjust it later. So a well-trained team, if you have a really good team for developers, for project managers, for designers, then it isn't much more expensive, I think, if you invest in training.
Right. Another question. This is aside the WordCamp. All right, let's ask the question. I'm going to come back to my question later. Do you have suggestions to get the accessibility word out to developers and business owners? How can we make people more aware about accessibility?
Well, there's two different groups. business owners, I always say, you spend a lot of time and energy and money for SEO to get all those people to your website. And then 20% of those people leave because they cannot use the website. So you throw 20% of all your money away. And that's such a pity, because that 20% are also customers, are also people who will spend money on your website. So you send them away. And that's a huge loss. So I think from a business point of view, it's very good to have an accessible website, because you have more people able to use the website. The developers, I find this hard to answer, because I struggle with this too. I see accessibility as a part of the quality of your code. A lot of developers like to make fancy stuff, like to learn new frameworks, like to the latest of the latest and apply that. I understand that, because that's fun to do, but they forget the basics. Like, what is HTML? What's HTML really like? How does the web really work? Yeah. And that's accessibility. Just how does the web really work? What is decent HTML? And that's not sexy. So the latest framework, that's sexy, and that is fun to learn. And going back to basics, I struggle with that too. I don't have a good answer on that. But we give training at the Alu Collective for developers to learn and go back to basics. So I think it's good quality. Web should work for everyone. But I don't know a real good answer for developers.
No, but that was more elaborative. Thank you for that answer. But let's just move to the next comment. I think we have a few more comments coming up. So Larry says that ADA lawsuits are more expensive than accessibility upfront.
True. I think the lack of accessible website comes from that developers do not know what's important. In the Netherlands, where I live, it's not taught on the schools. I don't know how it is in the US. I think that's the same, that it's not part of the education of developers. Like, that's a really a lot of developers come from school, or they teach themselves, and accessibility is not something they really encounter. So if it works for them, it works. That's just how the web is now. So if they if a website owner and a website agency doesn't train their team, they just don't know. So they build inaccessible websites, and then the lawsuits in the US, that's not in Europe the case, but in the US the lawsuits come. And that's a lot of money you could have built from scratch website that right. will be less costly. Yeah.
Absolutely. We have about 4 minutes remaining, and I want to make sure that we take advantage of the time that we have with you, Rian, answering all the questions coming from this eager group of audience. So let's jump to the next comment, please. So we have a comment coming from Carol. In my former life, I was a social worker, and we always said, start where the client is and work from there. It seems working with clients and doing baby steps towards accessibility. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I don't know what baby steps is.
I think he's, I think Carol, apologies. Carol is simply in saying that we take small steps towards accessibility, make small changes, but then again, we should build it from scratch, right? Accessibility should be embedded in the basics.
Yeah, but if you already have a current website running, then you can maybe discuss with the client, like, well, the color contrast could be improved. Like, do the quick wins first, like color contrast. Or if you build some new functionality for the website, make that accessible. And then it's baby steps for a current project. And maybe the client needs some convincing and doesn't need, well, oh, I don't want to rebuild my whole website. Well, I can understand that, because that's a lot of money. So you can do small things to make it more accessible. And then after 3 years, when you have to rebuild the thing anyway, then you can make the big leap to make it better overall.
I see more comments coming in. Let's jump to the next one. I think it's coming from Meryl. Meryl, one of our speakers and a long-term advocate for accessibility.
Hey, well. I know you.
She says, I and many others say progress, not perfection. If we wait until things are perfect, we'd never have captions or any of the other tools. What do you think about that?
That's very, very true. Yeah. It is. If you wait until everything is perfect and implemented, then if it's only if it's already better, it's better, it's good. She says it's much better than I do. Yeah, I agree with that 100%.
Meryl also says events bugs me when. So I think the comment starts from. It bugs me when A11Y supporters go after companies that do accessibility. For example, supporter complained about a company's alternative text. Go after those who don't alter text at all. Interesting.
I don't know this. Okay. Maybe I'm too European for this.
Maybe we can continue the discussion in the Slack later on.
Yeah.
Let me just let's jump on to the question that I had for you. So we only have about a minute and a half. So we want equity. We want equality. We want the justification that everyone gets a fair share, diversified planet. Where do you think accessibility stands when we're talking about inclusion in your own mind?
Well, web accessibility is that everybody should be able to use the web. Everybody should be included in using the web. And that's especially important for people with a disability, because most of the time they depend on accessible websites for their basic needs. And people who don't have a disability can go to the shop and buy something. But if you are bound to your house, then you need a good web shop. So I think accessibility, web accessibility, that everybody can use the web and can order online and can do all those things, makes them that they're included into the rest of the world, and that they can function as an independent person instead of asking everything from everyone, that they can independently live. And that's essential, I think, for accessibility. Give them people the freedom.
Right. Thank you so much, Rian, for the extended contribution with the question answer session.
You're welcome.
We're going to wrap things up, but I want to remind our viewers, if you still have questions for Rian, please use the WCSCV general Slack channel. You should all have received a link in your email that you registered for the WordCamp. And also, I want to remind all of you to attend the next talk, Accessible Typography with Stefano Minoia at 10 a.m. here on the same track. I want to thank Rian once again for joining WordCamp Santa Clarita as a speaker. We hope to see you again, and we also want to have your input in the coming days. We have another day tomorrow for WordCamp Santa Clarita. Until then, thank you so much. See you again. Take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.